everyone, and thanks for joining us today for Studio One. I'm Scott Sila, along with Kim Fisher, Jennifer Vandergon, and Craig Trellman. We have another great show on the way for you today, and we're going to tell you about it in just a minute. But first, Jennifer, what's the main story you're working on today?
Prisoner of War Michael Durant is free, and he's on his way to Germany right now.
And that's good news, mm-hmm. definitely.
And Craig, good weather this weekend?
Well, it looks like we should have a pretty fair weekend.
Good to hear.
No snow. That's
no
good.
Snow.
Straight ahead on Studio One this half hour, a University of North Dakota geology professor will talk about the devastating earthquake in his homeland of India, which killed nearly 10,000 people and injured thousands of others.
And later in our second half hour, North Dakota's Human Services Director Bud Wessman will talk about if families are making ends meet and if they're better off now than before.
The weather and but first, Jennifer Vandergon has the top news stories at this hour. Jennifer?
Thanks, Scott. Freed U.S. pilot Michael Durant has said goodbye to the Somali city where he spent 11 days in captivity. He left Mogadishu for a hospital in Germany. Durant and a U.N. peacekeeper from Nigeria were freed Thursday by clan leader Mohammed Farah Aidid. Durant was captured by Aidid militiamen after his helicopter was shot down during a battle in Mogadishu. Doctors say he has a crushed vertebrae, a broken cheekbone, and a fractured leg. And though he may need additional surgery, they expect a full recovery. Durant will be met in Germany by his wife. President Clinton spoke to Durant Thursday, thanking him for his service, patriotism, and bravery. The transition to democracy in Haiti has suffered another major setback. Gunmen assassinated Haitian Justice Minister Guy Mallory, his two bodyguards, and his driver Thursday. Mallory was appointed as a part of a United Nations brokered plan to establish a democratic government. Earlier this week, armed mobs prevented UN forces from docking in Port-au-Prince to help implement the agreement. The Battle of the Bulge is one of the main concerns among doctors recently. Studies prove that more of us are fatter today than in the late 70s. Children are following in their parents' footsteps, leading less active lifestyles. Doctors blame the increased obesity levels on high-fat diets, while dietitians explain that there are more reasons than one.
One factor can be because of heredity. Another can be because they're eating too high-fat foods or they're too inactive. But it doesn't really matter. The thing is if you're eating too much and you're not burning it off, you're going to become overweight or obese.
Streitz says obesity can also be blamed on the popularity of television in the 90s. She says kids are more likely to play Nintendo or watch TV than go outside and play. You might not have to go outside for anything soon if you have access to a vending machine. Vending machines that drop pizza, cappuccino, French fries, and even pantyhose into the hands of consumers are the latest in vending trends. Companies are now designing new vending machines that cook almost anything. Frozen French fries can be heated up to perfection with the push of a button. Consumers pay a dollar for each box of golden brown fries, and if the fries don't fill you up, there's a vending machine that makes pocket sandwiches filled with sausage, cheese, beef, or pepperoni. What if the vending machine food gives you an upset stomach? Well, don't worry, there's also a machine that distributes Philips Milk of Magnesia. The University of North Dakota is known for its excellence in aviation. An extracurricular group that has helped them earn this reputation is constantly perfecting their flying skills. Reporter Patrice Lee has more.
Most college students are still sleeping Sunday morning when 6 a.m. rolls around, but not this group of aviation students. This group, the University of North Dakota flight team, meets all year long to prepare for competitions. During practice, there are five planes that take off one after the other. The pilots in the planes are judged by other members on their landing. There are other areas of competition besides flying. There is a pre-flight contest where pilots make sure the plane is in running condition. There is also a navigation test where they have to plan a flight in 30 minutes.
All of the hours and money spent on practice is expected to pay off when the team goes to the regional and national competitions.
The team's coach says these competitions are taken seriously.
We have, a lot of good pilots. But there are other people that would really like to win the competition and work very hard to do that. So they have to excel in order to win.
At the end of each practice, the team goes through a debriefing where the coach tells them what they need to improve on and what they did right. The team also has a captain whose job is much like the captain of a sports team.
We are we're responsible for motivating the team, getting people pumped up, for the competitions or the testing sessions that we have, both in the ground events back on campus and out here at, on Sunday mornings along the runway.
The planes the flight team uses are owned by the university. These are the planes the flight team will use when they take off for competitions. With photographer Ryan Arneson, Patrice Lee, Studio One News.
The team placed first in a regional competition last year and fourth in nationals. And the team is in St. Cloud this weekend for the regional competition again this year.
Let's hope they do just as well this year. Thanks, Jennifer. Well, this may not be the best weekend to stay indoors and watch the World Series. Craig joins us now with the weekend weather. Craig?
Well, thanks, Kim, and you are right. This may not be the best weekend to stay inside. But currently in Grand Forks, we're under a cloudy sky. Our temperature is 37 degrees. The winds are out of the east at 6 miles an hour. And our barometric pressure is on the fall. Well, as we take a look at some temperatures around the region this morning, we're going to see some pretty favorable temperatures. In fact, most of us are in the mid-40s. There is some 30s, and our cool spot this morning is at International Falls at 22. The Twin Cities is at 46, Fargo is at 40, and Bismarck is at 44. Well, as we take a look at some fronts around the nation today, we're going to see a lot of activity happening, especially in the southeastern part of the United States. In Florida, there is a lot of precipitation happening this morning. This is due to the warm front, which has pushed its way down into the south and is pushing its way to the Atlantic Ocean, bringing a lot of precipitation with it. We're seeing some precipitation over the midwestern sections of the United States and even up into the Dakotas. This is due to the low pressure system, which has dropped its way down from Canada, and it's combining with this low pressure system coming from the west coast, bringing some weekend showers throughout the weekend. Well, there is a chance that we're going to see some rain today, but most of it should be to the southwest, South Dakota and the Nebraska area. As we look further into the weekend, most of that rain is going to push out of our area into the Great Lakes area, only giving us about a 20% chance of seeing any rain, so most of it is going to be out of our area. Well, our temperatures this weekend should be really nice. In fact, the nation is going to be under pretty nice temperatures. We're going to see 50 degree skies. There's going to be some 60s and 70s, and in the extreme south, there will be some 80s. Well, like I said, today we're going to see some pretty favorable temperatures. In fact, we should see temperatures right around the 55 to 60 degree mark. We're going to see some cloudy skies. There is a slight chance we'll see some showers today, and our winds are going to switch to the southeast. As we look into tonight, it's going to be pretty nice tonight. The clouds may lift some. They're still going to be around. We're going to see a low right around 35 degrees, and the winds are going to switch to the north, gusting up to about 15 miles an hour. And as we take a look into the weekend, it's going to be pretty nice. The clouds are going to hang around, but as we look into next week, we should be seeing some sunny skies. It should be rather pleasant. So, Scott and Kim, I know you love baseball, but you might want to get outside this weekend.
Thanks, Craig. Well, nice weather this weekend, but are you going to stay inside and watch the World Series?
Everyone has to watch
at least
the first game.
That's okay. Right.
In sports, the pitching lineup has been decided for the first game of the World Series. Curt Schilling for Philadelphia and Juan Guzman for Toronto. The first two games will be at the Toronto Sky Dome beginning Saturday night. In the National League, the Calgary Flames edging the San Jose Sharks 2-1. Joe Nieuwendyk scored a power play goal in the second period, snapping a 1-1 tie. Hartford dumped Chicago 6-2. Pat Verbeek finishing with a hat trick and an assist. Verbeek with his eighth career hat trick. The win, snapping the Whalers' six-game losing streak at Chicago Stadium. Rob Niedermeyer's first NHL goal gave Florida a 5-4 win over the winless Ottawa Senators. It was the first ever home win for the expansion Panthers. And finally, in football Thursday night, Billy Joel Tolliver making his first start of the season threw a career-high 3 touchdown passes, including a 42-yard bomb to Andre Rison to give the Falcons a come-from-behind 30-24 win over the Rams. Those are the highlights. Local sports news still ahead on Studio One. But first, a look now at the rest of the overnight sports scores. The University of North Dakota's volleyball team went into this year's season with a fresh look. The Sioux had their first conference win, bringing their record to 1-3 in the conference. The young team has 4 new starters, all who look up to the experience of one co-captain. Studio One sports reporter Jennifer Dietrich has more.
The Sioux volleyball team wants to make more noise in the conference, so they listened to co-captain Maria Oystead-Bruggeman. The senior is a returning starter for the Sioux, leading the team both in offense and defense.
During any drills, I mean, I work hard. I might not say a whole lot, you know, like when I'm working, I try not to, you know, whine a lot. I try to just do the best I can. And I think that rubs off on a lot of them. They're gonna try hard, they're gonna do their best.
Bruggeman helped her team to a victory this week against Augustana at the Hislop Sports Center. With 11 blocks, she shot down the Augustana defense.
I think this weekend really showed up that our captains are starting to take control, and Marie did a great job with blocking, and that really makes it forceful on the court that you're in charge.
Brueggemann is a second season player. She leads the team in solo blocks and holds the UND record for 8 block assists. As an all-conference honorable mention choice last year, she has new goals set this season.
Last year, because I was all region but not all conference, and I think I kind of want to prove, you know, to the whole conference that I can, you know, be as good as anybody in this conference.
The team schedule may be the ultimate test for the UND women, but Coach Clark says her group could surprise people. As for Brueggemann, the senior hopes to continue hearing the victory cheers from the crowd. Jennifer Diedrich, Studio One Sports.
The Sioux are on the road this weekend for 2 more conference games, one against St. Cloud and the other against Mankato. A lot of traveling on the road.
That's right. Let's hope it doesn't affect their playing.
Exactly. There is still much more ahead on today's edition of Studio One, including the struggle this fall of harvesting crops. Despite Mother Nature's blows, an area man says it's still worthwhile.
But first, here's a look at what's going on around the area this week. Stay with us as Studio One continues.
I would recommend banking at Community National Bank for location, consistent customer service, efficiency as far as transactions are concerned. When I call Community National Bank, I typically ask for Lana, just because she knows my accounts and knows some of the transactions that I've taken care of in the past. If she's not in, someone will take care of me just as though she were there on the same consistent and efficient basis. Good personal bank.
Come to the Red Hot Dot Sale at Columbia Mall.
Look for Red Hot Red Dots at many of your favorite stores, on many of your favorite items. When you find a store with Red Hot Red Dots, you'll find huge savings. All you have to do is find the Red Hot Red Dots to save. Whoa!
Look for Red Hot Red Dots Friday through Monday only at Columbia Mall, Grand Forks.
They're easy to find.
One of Mother Nature's powers, which we have no control over, is earthquakes. Recently, a massive earthquake in India hit 6.0 on the Richter scale. It killed an estimated 10,000 people and injured several thousand others. Today, UND geology professor Dr. Sundar Saluja joins us to discuss how this huge catastrophe has affected his home country. Thanks for joining us today, Doctor.
You're welcome.
Now, this is very important to you because you have family in India.
Yes.
What? How did they respond to the earthquake when you talked to them?
Well, they all feel very sad, but they were at a safe distance from there, some 300 miles southwest.
Mm-hmm. So they do they feel a big part of it, or were any buildings?
No, they felt jolts, but no casualties were there in that town. But everybody felt sad with mm-hmm. so many people dying. Actually, the people, over 20,000 people have died.
20,000 people. Now, that's a large number. And
large.
Can you explain the type of devastation that has happened there?
Actually, you know, this zone has a very large lava solidified mass, thousands of square miles, and having been very hard and stable, not much drilling was done. And it was considered to be seismically inactive. The building codes were much simpler. It's very rich farmland. People were prosperous, and they built stone and concrete houses, but not reinforced structures. The result was that when it came, really, houses collapsed over them, particularly because it was at night at about 3:54 a.m., and people were just sleeping. Mm-hmm. People who survived were those who were still awake on street celebrating a kind of puja for one of their gods.
Now, is this the first earthquake that has happened in this area, or has it been a repeated
occurrence? No, there was one in 1967, and the casualties were very few, but that was the first time there was a feeling that this may be seismically active. And then the order number one of seismic activity was given. But after that, there was nothing. Now they are feeling that probably the Indian plate, even in that area, is active, and more precautions will be taken.
Mm-hmm. Are building codes going to be upgraded so that this probably won't happen, the buildings collapse?
Definitely. Actually, some of the reinforced buildings, even in that area, survived fairly well. And if those buildings had been constructed with a little better code, probably casualties would be so, mm-hmm. not so many.
When the earthquake first happened, we heard a lot about, you know, all the destruction and how many people were killed. Now, that was about a couple weeks ago. What is the update on it now? Are people still homeless? Are they finding where to go? Are they starting the cleanup? Or what exactly is happening?
Well, there are about 150,000 people who have become homeless. They are being rehabilitated. World Bank has given about $300 million. And Government of India has promised that they'll build house for everyone. Mm-hmm. And there has been a lot of response from the international community. A lot of aid went from US and from several other countries.
So a lot of help from the Red Cross and everything.
Actually, prior to this, India had never accepted aid from any other country for this kind of thing. This is the first time they felt that they needed it. And I'm glad that international community really mm-hmm. responded.
Is it tough for you being here in Grand Forks and hearing about an earthquake in your homeland? Is it tough for you to hear about and not actually be there and help the people?
Well, it definitely is, because you can't do much except think of sending some money, and that's all. Mm-hmm.
When's the next time you plan on going back?
I'll be going this December.
This December. Now, there will still be the cleanup going on then. Do you plan on bringing anything with you or any other help?
I'm having a listserv with some professionals, 300 professionals on the computer network, and we are trying to raise some money and do something.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're a geology professor also.
I'm a professor of mining, actually, but in the Department of Geology and Geological Engineering.
So this is interesting to you, not only for the personal side, but also on the professional career side for you.
Yes, to some extent.
Do you want to go over there and just study the earthquake?
No, I don't have that kind of time, because the break is only 3 weeks. I'm not sure, because there are two other things that I have to attend to.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, Dr. Saluja, thank you for joining us today, and good luck on your trip back in December. We hope the best for you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Why don't you just stay here just for a second? We'll be right back.
Okay.
Still ahead on Studio One, we'll visit a small Minnesota town invaded by aliens who wanted to teach the language from their homeland. That's later in our program. But coming up next on Studio One, all the songs the music group The Police have done over their career are being re-released. They're modernizing sound through technology and putting the final product out on compact discs. We'll give you a taste of what it sounds like next on Studio One.
Food can come from anywhere, as long as the shredded natural cheese comes from Sargento of Wisconsin.
October 1987, a small child is rescued from an abandoned well. No country comes to the aid of a child the way we do. Yet today, millions of children need our help, lost in an education system unable to prepare them for today's competitive world. Imagine if that same effort went into keeping the promise that every child gets the best education and has a future. Call 1-800-96-PROMISE for information on changing the schools in your community.
Music plays a major role in nearly all of our lives. And now the music group Police, including Sting himself, are releasing all their songs on a compact disc set. Studio One's Wyvon Fisher has the story.
The Police is sending an SOS through their videos and CDs that feature all their popular hits of the 70s. Songs like Roxanne, Message in a Bottle, Every Breath You Take, and Don't Stand So Close to Me, along with several live versions of songs not circulated in the 70s market. Even though many of the Police's songs are old, they are modernizing the sound by making music videos and putting them on CDs. Wyvon Fisher, Studio One.
We'll be back with more on Studio One, including a picture-perfect postcard of America's heartland.
Many have witnessed its awesome power. It is a strategic device of immense importance. It can bring into range an entire nation, a single neighborhood, or any segment of the populace. And most remarkable of all, it's growing even stronger as advertisers and viewers use it in record numbers. From Main Street to Madison Avenue, America's sold on cable.
Call to see how low-cost cable advertising can be effective for your business.
Disaster strikes someone every single day. There's always going to be one more night. Someone needs food, shelter, and a place to rest. Please support the American Red Cross. Because without your help, one more night could be hard to come by.
That's my dad. And that's Mom. Dad's got an idea. A way to get rid of all the grody garbage that's polluting the world. He's invented a big rocket ship to shoot all the garbage into outer space. Mom's not sure, but Dad says his invention will save the world.
There's an easier way to save the world. Recycle. For your free recycling action guide, write Recycle. Environmental Defense Fund, 257 Park Avenue South, New York, New York.
All across America, farmers have had a difficult time harvesting. And in a summer where heavy rains and flooding ruined buildings, communities, and crops, many thought there would be nothing left to harvest. However, despite the destruction, even here in the Red River Valley, there is something to harvest. And during this season, combining can be a beautiful sight, one which even Norman Rockwell would love to paint a picture of.
A picture-perfect sight of North Dakota's countryside. The grain fields ripened and ready for harvest. The golden fields still standing despite all the punches Mother Nature threw their way this year, from floods to heat and hail. Today, after all of this, the farmer has reached his goal. It's harvesting season in the Red River Valley, and for farmers, it's a time for celebrating. Lyle Schumacher has been farming all his life and has experienced every up and every down in the business.
This is the highlight. This is the climax of the year, you know, doing the harvesting. Everything leads towards this. Either you make it or you don't. Today is the day.
But harvesting today has changed. It's much easier and faster now than in the days when combining was called thrashing.
Well, I come from the horse and the thrash machine days. Yeah, I've been here 62 years and we've always thrashed something. And some years it's more and some years it's less. And Mother Nature usually don't let us down completely. And most of the time, very good to us.
The Schumacher farm is definitely a family operation. Lyle and his brother and each of their two sons will harvest nearly 4,000 acres this fall.
Happy that we got something to harvest. Some farmers haven't, down in a flood area. We're very thankful for what we get. We'll try and hang in there another year. We don't tell our story too well. Most people in the city got the wrong impression of the farmer.
Uh-huh.
Everybody should get a little dirt under their fingernails. Everybody should have a farm sometime in their life.
Today, Lyle is harvesting spring wheat. He's only interested in getting the grain, cutting the crop high, and leaving lots of stubble in the fields.
Beautiful. Music to our ears.
Lyle's combine can unload 200 bushels of grain in about 90 seconds. This year's crop will be put through a grain dryer system on the family farm and kept in storage bins over the winter months. It's harvesting season, and the combines are out in full force, creating dust that hugs the ground like a blanket of fog. And the farmer doesn't stop when the sun goes down, sometimes working by the light of the moon. The harvesting continues late into the night until the grain becomes too damp to combine.
Farmer to appreciate a crop like this, though.
The best thing I liked about that, there was no snow at all.
Definitely.
Straight ahead in our next half hour in Studio One, a UND professor has been named the top researcher in the United States for his work with human nutrition.
Plus, a look at how aliens invaded a small Minnesota town. Klingons from the movie Star Trek, The Next Generation left more than a few surprises for the small Minnesota town. They left an unpaid tab. All that and more still ahead on Studio One.
exposed to so many different ideas and projects. The engineering school here itself is set up so that it's the class size is reasonable and the professors are great.
Our equipment we use is up to date and very new and very accurate.
Part of the reason why I've gone into this program is because of the environmental aspects.
With about 12,000 students, UND is the largest university in the Dakotas, Montana, and western Minnesota. About 170 major fields provide education in careers that include engineering, law, medicine, aerospace, and business. Dedicated faculty, individual attention. Join us at the University of North Dakota.
Children are the largest group of Americans living below the poverty line. They have to reach higher for what others take for granted. Healthcare, balanced meals, encouragement to learn. But with help early on, children in your community can gain the skills to get out from below the poverty line. It takes programs like Success by Six and people like you to help them take the first step. Call to learn more. Change the world of a child, and you change the world.
Welcome back to the second half hour of Studio One. We're glad you're with us today because we still have a lot to tell you about.
And good weather this weekend, right, Craig?
Sure is. We should see temperatures right about in the mid-50s. Chance of some rain, not very much, so it should be a pretty nice weekend.
Good to hear.
Good. Thanks, Craig. Coming up on Studio One this final half hour, a look at how state-assisted families are dealing with their situation. Is the state doing enough or too much to help them get back on track? Human Services Director Bud Wessman will let us know.
Plus, a UND professor has been named the top researcher in the nation by U.S. Ag Secretary Mike Espy. He'll share his secrets with us.
But first, we turn to Jennifer Vandergon for the news update. Jennifer?
Thanks, Scott. The Pentagon says it's sending more U.S. troops to Somalia than it had originally announced. 2,700 U.S. Army soldiers, about 1,000 more than expected, are being deployed to beef up security for U.S. troops already in Mogadishu. Overall, some 20,000 U.S. forces will be stationed in the region. After hours of heated debate, the Senate voted on a March 31st deadline for the troops to return home. In Los Angeles, a judge has refused to remove a female juror in the trial of two men accused of beating truck driver Reginald Denny. Defense attorneys requested the dismissal, saying the woman was overly concerned with being separated from her boyfriend. Another woman juror was dismissed earlier this week because fellow jurors said she refused to deliberate, and a man was dismissed for personal reasons. The judge also denied a defense motion for a mistrial Thursday. Music lovers are finding a cheaper way to build their compact disc collections. Many record stores have started selling used CDs. These CDs are bought back from customers who get tired of a disc or just need extra cash. Retailers usually pay up to $4 for each CD. They are then resold for around $8. Used CDs are becoming increasingly popular because they are lower priced and they offer the same CD quality sound.
Any of these places that offer you CDs basically are guarantee them that they're not going to have scratches or anything like that too. So you're buying good music. You know, it's good music for you. You know, you can't turn down the price you're getting.
Record stores have picked up on the money saving idea. Used CDs are now sold in record stores nationwide. Statistics say racism on college campuses is on the decline. However, racism is still present. The most frequently used forms of racism are verbal racial stereotyping, condescending racist comments, and graffiti and differential treatment in classes. Such hate crimes against minority college students hamper academic and social skills. Blacks are more likely to suffer racist experiences than others. However, blacks can cope better, too. Latino and Asian students generally have a harder time with racism. Black students may expect more racism as they enter college and are better prepared to deal with it. Great herds of bison roamed the Great Plains of North America for hundreds of years. We've found bison are still roaming the plains of North Dakota. Studio One reporter Carla Booman has more.
These great beasts have been grazing on the North Dakota plains for centuries. Bison became the center of life for the Plains Indian. Today, bison provide a way of life for Jim Earl and his son Doug. Jim and Doug own and operate Siouxland Buffalo, located just west of Grand Forks. The Earls raise between 400 and 500 head of bison for market. Jim started the business about 25 years ago with two bison. The business has taken off.
There's more people all the time. That lady was just here. She'd never tried buffalo before.
Jim and Doug raise the bison from their own breeding stock and then process the animals themselves. The meat is packaged into various cuts and sold to local consumers. Jim says bison meat has gained in popularity due to its good qualities. Buffalo meat is low in cholesterol, higher in protein, and contains less fat than beef. Bison are not difficult animals to raise. Jim says the bison will eat anything cattle eat, such as hay, corn silage, and grass, but his seem to especially enjoy potatoes. Just as the Native Americans did in the past, the Earls make use of all parts of the buffalo. Inside their Siouxland buffalo shop, one can find products made from the bison Jim and Doug raise. Back scratchers from the ribs, moccasins and bracelets from the hide, and dog treats from the hooves. They even sell the skulls of the bison starting at $100. With photographer Jake Henningsgaard, this is Carla Booman with Studio One News.
The Earls have taken on a new venture with their bison herd. Starting this November, Jim and Doug will supply 50 head of bison a year to a new processing plant in New Rockford, North Dakota. College and university officials across the country are trying to find new ways to deal with an old problem, cheating. The American Council on Education conducted a survey of American freshmen in 1987 and 88. The results indicated about a 30% increase in cheating from 1987 to 1988. Many officials believe that cheating is a growing problem for a number of reasons.
I think that the issue of cheating isn't just a student issue. The issue of cheating is a societal one. I mean, the role models we have in our government and in business very clearly says, you know, to succeed is more important than the method by which you have come to that success.
Cheaters at UND are generally disciplined by their instructors. Cases may also be brought to the Dean of Students for evaluation. And Scott, going back to that buffalo story, they say that buffalo costs a little bit more, but the benefits may well be worth it.
Mm-hmm. I still have to try it yet.
I've tried it. It's actually pretty good.
It'll be next on my list. More and more people are seeing the benefits of learning a second language to communicate with people in other countries. But what if that language comes from another galaxy? A camp in Red Lake Falls, Minnesota combines sport activities with lessons to teach a language that's out of this world. Studio One's Jennifer Dietrich explains.
The next time you go to a softball game, check to see if you can understand the cheerleaders. Does the batter have a wrinkled, bumpy forehead? Will the umpire allow a llama in a carriage onto the softball diamond? If this does happen, it probably just means the opposing team is from outer space. The Klingons are warlike enemies to the starship Enterprise from the television series Star Trek. And a few Star Trek fans boldly traveled where no one has gone before, participating in the first Klingon camp to learn the bizarre language.
If you learn Spanish, you can go to Mexico or Spain and so forth, but it's a little tough to go to the Klingon Empire except in your fantasies. So we had to try to create a place where these people could meet and try to develop things and learn from each other.
The first obstacle every human has to overcome is pronunciation. There are difficult sounds like, which is best equated by imagining yourself gagging on peanut butter.
The Klingons challenged a group of Earthlings to a game of softball and made a few rules of their own, bringing their space battles closer to Earth.
I like to think of them as honor-bound, and when someone breaks the honor, like throwing a ball at the batter, one must correct them.
Great Klingon War softball game in Red Lake Falls. The
fifth. Oh, Kip! What did the Kostak edge?
The all-star team from Earth took an early lead, which was no surprise as team members were former Olympic and professional athletes.
I am probably one of the absolute best Star Trek fans.
I've watched it since the series began, and I'm in the Deep Space Nine and all the whole thing. I love it, absolutely love it. It is the future.
But when uneven scores began to develop, the Klingons took matters into their own hands.
An agonizer induces tremendous agony, direct neural stimulation. No one can withstand it.
At this unique camp, the Klingons have virtually taken over Red Lake Falls. From softball to a talent contest, they even had time for a little fun at the local tavern.
Well, this is going to sound pretty absurd. I'm not really a fanatic nut or anything, but I only got the costume and all when I started getting into the language, because what the heck, if you speak the language, you might as well look the part. This is what I refer to as the summer uniform. I have also a shirt with the fur sleeves. It was a little hot today for that.
Those at the Klingon camp are only a few of hundreds also following the correspondence course. They will be able to communicate with each other and follow the Klingon proverb.
Loop khut shi yin ku kashtavishwa loop yin put wat net yin may. And it means live well each second in 1 second lives a thousand lives.
Now this follow-up on the Klingon language cap. It seems they left the city of Red Lake Falls with a $3,000 debt. Purcell asked the city council to cover the expenses but was denied. However, the city council did approve $3,000 in grants and loans. Purcell says plans are already underway for another camp next year in July. Up next on Studio One, Kim will talk with State Human Services Director Bud Wessman on the status of families in North Dakota.
I would recommend banking at Community National Bank for location, consistent customer service, efficiency as far as transactions are concerned. When I call Community National Bank, I typically ask for Lana, just because she knows my accounts and knows some of the transactions that I've taken care of in the past. If she's not in, someone will take care of me just as though she were there on the same consistent and efficient basis. Good personal bank.
Come to the Red Hot Dot Sale at Columbia Mall.
Look for Red Hot Red Dots at many of your favorite stores, many of your favorite items. When you find a store with Red Hot Red Dots, you'll find huge savings. All you have to do is find the Red Hot Red Dots to save. Whoa!
Look for Red Hot Red Dots Friday through Monday only at Columbia Mall, Grand Forks.
They're easy to find.
Excuse me, do you wear your safety belt?
Why, no, I don't wear my safety belt.
Thank you.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
One out of every six families in North Dakota today are making ends meet with the help of state services. Unfortunate situations such as divorce and unemployment cause parents and their children to seek help from the state. Some may say the people using these services have brought on their own misfortune, while others argue more assistance should be given to them. North Dakota Human Services Director Bud Wessman joins us today to discuss the issues facing families and what is being done to get them back on their feet. Bud, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Kim. My pleasure.
As we said in the introduction, the Human Services Department touches one out of every six families in North Dakota. How does that compare to other states?
That comparison is not as bad, obviously, as in some of the states where you have higher populations and have more urbanized areas. We have a unique problem here in North Dakota in that we have the rural poor, and the ability to reach out into those rural areas, into those smaller communities, is something that gives us a particular shift of how we're going to handle that, as opposed to some of the urban problems, Detroit, Chicago, those sorts of things.
Now, Human Services deals with a variety of issues concerning families. Have you seen an increase in need in any particular area due to the changing family structure?
Well, the family structure, of course, however you may define it, we continue to have in North Dakota the same sorts of problems that the teenage pregnancies, the unemployment problem, although unemployment in North Dakota, as you know, is not as bad as it might be in some of the other areas. The areas dealing with divorce and with child custody and lack of payment, support payments once there is a divorce or the absent parent problem, these all, you know, build up and add into the problem that we have relevant to supporting families within the state.
Do you find that there's a particular age group that's seeking help nowadays?
The age group that traditionally and initially was intended to be helped were those in middle age, and you know the younger ones now. You're looking at the 18 to 24 year group, which is the short term ones. But you have some instances where you've had people on for longer periods of time. They tend to move up into the middle age area again.
Now, for those people receiving things such as food stamps, AFDC, are you finding that this is becoming a way of life for them? They're getting caught up in the dependency of the state?
There's a term we use called behavioral poverty, which relates to a way of life. And I know a lot of people, you know, this is a touchy topic because you have people on both sides. People say, we need this help, and I agree, they need the help. There's the other side, however, that say, we've got to do something to make these people more self-sufficient. We're trying to do that within the state because you do have, in North Dakota, roughly 16% of the AFDC recipients, for instance, who have been on anywhere from 60 to 120 months. I mean, you're talking 5 to 10 years.
What areas, if any, do you feel the Human Services Department is lacking, and what changes do you foresee?
Well, the lack is not as evident as the increasing need. We need to look in terms of how can you incentivize the individuals to get back into a productive situation. And we talk in terms of time-limited benefits, that is a social contract that says I am going to, within a two-year period of time, I'm going to have a job, I'm going to be doing some volunteer work, I'm going to be doing an educational program, something that will be beneficial to me and in turn repay back to society. This is not unusual. I mean, that was the intent with Franklin Delano Roosevelt back in the 30s when he established Social Security. It was intended to be a short-term thing. We drifted from that. I think we're going back in that direction again.
Do you feel that most of your clients are leaving satisfied and have a good grasp?
Well, it depends on how you define client. I mean, the client satisfaction surveys that we do at each of the human service centers indicate that we're doing a adequate job. I don't know that we're doing a good job. We can need to continue to do more. And certainly in this area of AFDC and food stamps, et cetera, you've got to look at both sides of the ledger. You've got to look at what you're doing, but also what you're, you know, are the individuals who are getting the services, do they really, do they deserve them? And it's what they need, not what they want, and we have to pay attention to that.
What is the primary goal of human services for the state of North Dakota?
Well, the mission of the Department of Human Services is to provide quality human services, that is, you know, to be of assistance to the individuals in need. And particularly we talk in terms of vulnerable people, those people who need our help. You're talking about children, you're talking about dysfunctional families, you're talking about the elderly. And of course, we cover all areas like Medicaid, we cover the AFDC, the food stamps, fuel assistance, the whole area. It's extremely, you know, you're talking a $930 million budget, so you're talking a fantastically large amount of money that is intended to be of assistance to people. But again, we've got to look at that time factor, and we've got to look at accountability. That's the other issue. How do you really know if you're doing what you want to do? We haven't got that one under control yet.
Well, Bud, I thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. My pleasure, Kim.
Still ahead on Studio One, Scott will be back and we'll talk with a Grand Forks man who has just been named a top researcher by the United States Department of Agriculture.
Were you guys born in a house?
Yeah. What have we got to graze on?
Nothing.
Please?
Now, don't be making those big cow eyes at... okay.
It is okay if you give them the good stuff. Mouton Snackers, cheese and sticks, or cheese and pretzels. The deliciously dippable snacks.
Animals.
from Motown Snackers.
Many have witnessed its awesome power. It is a strategic device of immense importance. It can bring into range an entire nation, a single neighborhood, or any segment of the populace. And most remarkable of all, it's growing even stronger as advertisers and viewers use it in record numbers. From Main Street to Madison Avenue, America's sold on cable.
Call to see how low-cost cable advertising can be effective for your business.
What is a man? A man stands proud. A man respects himself. A man shares his strength. A man protects his family. If you're a man with a woman who's pregnant, help her get the care she needs now. Because if you don't... For help, just call.
The University of North Dakota's Department of Agriculture has named a local doctor as the top research scientist in the nation for his work in human nutrition. Dr. Forrest Nielsen's research in the human diet and the importance of trace elements was the key in his receiving of this honor. And Dr. Nielsen joins us today to talk about what discoveries you've made at the center. Thanks for joining us today, Doctor.
Well, it's my pleasure to be here.
Can you tell us about the award you received directly from Ag Secretary Mike Espy himself?
Well, the award was for some work I've done in terms of defining the mineral nutrient requirements for humans. I went to Washington, D.C. about 2 weeks ago and had a ceremony on the Mall, received the award directly from Mike Espy. Part of that ceremony, incidentally, was having Willie Nelson and his group given us a concert after the awards were received. Good old farm aid boy himself was the one who serenaded us.
Yeah. Are you a Willie Nelson fan?
Oh, I always enjoy Willie Nelson. My cowboys are always...
Well, why don't you tell us about the research that made you get the award?
Well, the research that I've been involved with is defining newer trace elements in nutrition, which ones have not been recognized as being important elements, such as nickel, boron, arsenic. And also, I've been looking at elements which have been established as being important in the past, magnesium and copper, but for which have not been recognized as being important. I'm trying to show that they really are important and to maintain good cardiovascular health, prevent heart attacks, and for maintaining good, healthy bones, preventing osteoporosis in older women.
Now, these trace elements, they're all part of the periodic table of elements, correct?
That's correct. Okay. We are talking about mineral elements here, yes.
And how do they relate to the people's diet, say, like in the food they eat?
Well, our mineral elements, depending on which one you're talking about, come from a variety of sources. That's why we in USDA, we have this food triangle, which says that you should eat a variety of foods and in different amounts. The elements that I'm very interested in terms of providing good health, usually are found in your whole grains, your fruits, vegetables, nuts, which are really a good source of many of our mineral nutrients, but a lot of people are afraid of them because they think they're high calorie. But they're also a good food.
Yeah. In your research, you know, in the fast-paced life that all of us lead pretty much here day to day, is there a habit of having bad nutrition in our diets? Is our nutrition getting more balanced in our meals, or what's the consensus?
That's a tough question. There are a significant number of people out there who are in their fast-paced life not eating the right kind of foods that have, they're not getting enough of the whole grains, the vegetables, the fruits. There are more of a tendency for the meats, the refined foods, the rice, potatoes, and corn, and lettuce, and thinking they're getting fruits and vegetables, mm-hmm. and they are not. So I would say there are a great number of people out there who are not receiving eating the kind of diet they should be eating.
Can they make that up by taking vitamins every day?
A lot of people would hope they could. The trouble is we still don't know the right proportions for some of these nutrients, and it's the best way to get it is still through food. But if people are interested in taking supplements, and I want to emphasize this, I think a one-a-day vitamin mineral supplement is the best way. Don't try to take individual nutrients, say calcium or boron or magnesium or vitamin E or something like this. Just take one a day type of thing. But the best way is to get it from food.
The easiest. And Now, what's the current research going over at your facility right now that would be interesting to people?
Well, right now we have a group of postmenopausal women who are participating in a study in which we're studying the importance of magnesium in maintaining good bone health and cardiovascular function. This is a nutrient that has an RDA, but it's based on data that was produced in the 1960s with a group of 9 people, so we feel that we need to reestablish and reaffirm what is the true requirements for this element to maintain good health.
Now, is your research just for the Red River Valley, or is it spread across the United States?
As a department of the agriculture facility, and there's only 5 in the United States, our focus is the United States, mm-hmm. and we're located in UND area because of its medical school and because Senator Milton Young was very instrumental in assuring that we were located here.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But we are a national facility. We're 1 of 5 human nutrition research centers throughout the United States.
Good. Very interesting. Thanks for joining us today. Congratulations on your award. It's a very great honor.
Well, thank you.
Okay. There's still much more ahead on Studio One, and we'll tell you about it right after this.
Here's one time it doesn't matter who your neighbor is. Here's the other. Life's too short. Stop the hate.
You're gonna be better than me, Christopher. I can see it in your eyes.
No wasting your life on something you hate.
Not for my son. You're going to college. I can see it in your eyes.
I can see it in your eyes. You are going to do something important.
Christopher, time for work.
We've always had the dreams. Now we have the means. Please, support the United Negro College Fund.
If you can't use force to stop a friend from drinking and driving,
hop in.
Use your wits.
This is your car.
Yeah.
My brother had the same car. He never let me drive it, though.
No?
So you must have had me in mind when you bought this. Wait till he hears you've got the same one, and you let me drive it, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Take the keys, call a cab, take a stand. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
That's it for today's edition of Studio One, and we're going to leave you today with more pictures of harvesting in the Red River Valley. And we owe our thanks to Jake Henningsgaard from Studio One, who put it all together. And before we leave, we want to say happy anniversary to our senior director, Marv Lyer, and his wife, Cindy. I'm Scott Silent. For everyone here at Studio One, thank you very much for joining us. Looking forward to you next week. Have a great weekend, everyone.
This farm for about 62 years.
Yeah.